My name's Kurt Frulla. Thank you for coming. I'm the Deputy Director of the Rapid Equipping Force. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the organization, where we are right now, entertain your questions. So let's get started. That way we can get the questions faster. So obviously this is why we're here. And one of the things the ref is probably best aligned to is adaptability. Okay, so our mission, when I show it to you in a second, is to take existing capabilities, tailor them to existing tactical problems reported directly from the field, and providing immediate type solutions to those capability gaps. Okay, so how do we do that? We'll talk about it in a minute, but that is how we're aligned to adaptability. We're aligned to deployed forces predominantly, and we're focused on solving tactical problems being experienced by deployed forces. That's where our sweet spot is. Next slide. Okay, so obviously innovation, differentiation, long-term process over time. Okay, how the ref plays here is really increasing the rate of innovation. From the purpose, when the ref was stood up in 2002, it was basically designed to insert existing capabilities, technologies, or emerging technologies into the force and assist with the fight. It was trying to get that rate of innovation accelerated. We were given unique authorities to do that, where we could focus on existing problem sets and insert those capabilities into the field. This is how, basically, that we've increased the rate of innovation. What's our output? Our output is trying to influence program of records, the deliberate acquisition process, and to provide that information so requirements can be closer in the deliberate acquisition process first time round, and accelerate that deliberate capability in the future to the force. Really informing the existing traditional processes, requirements and acquisition, on how existing technology is working and how that can help modify the requirements that are in development. Or if there's no requirement in development, cue the requirement side to get a requirement started, because we know how long that takes. Next slide. Here's our mission. Predominantly, we're the Rapid Equipping Force. Our first task is to equip. Okay, that's taking existing non-standard equipment and getting it straight to the force, minor testing on it, and ensuring that we provide an assessment back on how that capability performs. Insert, okay, that's taking a look at future technologies, or where the field has not asked for a capability, and we see an opportunity and we put that into the force. A good example for that is tactical aerostat. With the base closures going on in Iraq, or correction, in Afghanistan, the director saw a need to put elevated ISR on the COPs and FOBs. It became required across the theater as they closed COPs and FOBs, as they took down the more strategic aerostats, to leave the tactical aerostats up. That's an example of where we insert a technology based on the director's intimacy with the field, working with the theater, understanding what kind of capabilities are required, and then inserting that into the force and providing that feedback. Now we're, based on that, that started off in Afghanistan, we're doing elevated ISR with tactical aerostat in Iraq right now. We also anticipate seeing that transition to a program of record under the appropriate acquisition authority. Assess, okay, this is our big output. You saw on the rate of innovation line that we had blue lines pointing down towards the blue lines pointing out. Our output is the assessment of these products. Our output is how these products can be influencing requirements, and our output is also to make sure that the right parts of the Army are informed on the capabilities that we're working. Next slide. Okay, so how do we do it, and how are we different than, we're not acquisition, and we're not requirements. What are we? We're kind of like a hybrid, okay? So modeled after SOCOM, after some of the authorities found in a unique organization within Special Operations Command, back in 2002, the senior leadership of the Army established us with unique authorities. The director at a Rapid Equipping Force has the authority to approve his own requirements. He doesn't execute the dollars, but he can approve his own requirements. Those requirements are approved on behalf of the deployed force commander, sergeant, whoever is identifying that tactical need or that tactical shortfall. So how are we fast? The first thing is we've got requirements authority delegated from the HQDA G3. Okay, so that is really the magic in the process. The second portion that we have that's critical to us is acquisition authority. The Army Acquisition Executive, Ms. Hsu, has assigned a PM in direct support of the Rapid Equipping Force. So I have unique requirements approval authority, and I have a PM sitting there with me to execute those requirements on behalf of the deployed forces. That's all great, all right? That's two of the pillars. The last thing I have is funding, okay? It always gets precarious with funding and palm drills. Anyone that's been around them understands we're funded, we're not funded, we're funded. Well, we're funded, and we've predominantly with OCO dollars, and we have some base dollars. So what are we charged to do? With the OCO dollars, has to be going to the theaters of operation right now that accept OCO dollars. With the base dollars we have, we can influence any one of the combatant commands, Army Service Component commands within them, or the Global Reaction Forces. So that's where we focus those base dollars against requirements that they have. Next slide. So adapt in the near term. Okay, so again, looking at the pace of innovation. Here's some of the examples that we use that we'll put up there that were adaption of capabilities towards capability shortfalls. We talked about elevated ISR already, containerized weapon station, working with the appropriate PMs, PM soldier weapons up out of Picatinny, as well as a PM, escapes me right down here at Amerdeck area. But integrating Crow's weapon stations onto a container so that they can be put in the field, and that's basically us facilitating that integration process for base defense forward. Got a lot of demand for it right now between Horn of Africa, Iraq, and Afghanistan. Okay, and obviously that'll transition to a program of record. We'll be out of it as soon as we can. One of the things to make sure that you realize about the ref, we don't want to be the PM for long term. Okay, the longer we carry something, the longer it's a drag on my funding, and the longer I can't do something else. Okay, so when you're looking at that rate of innovation, a rate of adaption, it also has to take into consideration rate of transition or divestiture. If we do something and there's no appetite for it, that's just as good. We've tried something, we can report out on it, and we cut. All right, we don't continue down that road. You won't get that necessarily from the deliberate requirements and acquisition process because they're held to that requirement to continue to do it. Okay, they're going to continue to do it until it runs into a CSB or something along those lines that alleviates them from where they're failing. We will cut and stop working on something and move to the next product. So transition for our rate of innovation is critical. Using the containerized weapon station as an example. Next one we have is the Expeditionary Lab. Okay, so started out the labs in about 2003 or 4 where we had science guys forward linked up with 11 Bravo E7s and E8s working with units on tactical problems and fabricating parts and solutions to what they were have for what their problem sets were. They'd go on patrols with deployed units. They'd see what that actual capability shortfall was in contact with the enemy. They'd go back and build a solution geared towards whatever that problem set they were having. Okay, fast forward to today. We've divested ourselves from carrying the science folks ourselves. We're leveraging with RDECOM, General Cole's help and resource us with fast team engineers that now man our labs. So we're getting that synergy with the RDECOM fast team area. We've got reach back capability to the rest of the RDEX to help fabricate stuff. Within the labs, we can 3D print materials, we can hang the print for it, and if it's something that works well, we can provide that capability back for mass manufacturing back here to meet the capability gap forward. And so it's adapting those technologies within the lab and now leveraging the organic capabilities within RDECOM to make that work. Finally, hybrid power. There's nothing, we have a huge demand for any kind of hybrid power out there, guys. And rate of innovation on that is obvious. The technology rate has been really turning quickly. We can stay with inside the technology rate. Why? Because we have that requirements approval capability. We work with PME2E regularly. They're our partner there, and we leverage them, they leverage us, and there's just a high rate of inserting new technologies in that capability shortfall area for the more austere environments that the soldiers are operating in. Next slide. Innovate in the far term. Our intent here is to influence programs of record with requirements that are closer to right. Okay, I'll go through a couple. This is the blue line going down to the bottom arrow on the first chart. The real intent here is to make sure that we provided the information back from what we've learned to a program of record so it can be articulated appropriately within the requirements document. The PM will be held to what's in the requirements document. If it's not right, you're going to get a product that's not right. I mean, that's how the acquisition process works, the requirements process works. So what we have up here, let's jump to blast effects. We've been running, I guess, about 5 years. We were given a vice chief directive to work on blast effects, blast sensors, and the impacts that has on mild traumatic brain injury with soldiers in vehicles, dismounted soldiers. Over time, we've done our experimentation working with PEO soldier. We transitioned that information to their program of record, which influenced the requirement they went in at with milestone B to ensure they were closer to right. So a great example of how a ref direct, in this case, a vice initiative, was executed and helped provide that information to a program of record in a more rapid fashion. Taking us out of the loop, it might have extended the program to get that knowledge. They'd still have to go down that learning curve as the PM and extend that developmental timeline to get the product to the soldiers. LMAMS, you see LMAMS over on the table there, working with AMRDEC. SOCOM initiative, we helped put that in the field to conventional forces, and then we're ready to partner for the next phase, because there'll be a new phase for LMAMS, there'll be a new requirement for it, and we'll be working on that. Okay, next slide. Okay, so one of the more important factors is, now that we've been institutionalized, although I didn't go into it, we were, in 2002, we worked directly for the Vice Chief of Staff of the Army. Sometime thereafter, in about 2006, we worked for the headquarters DAG3, or direct report to the G3. Fast forward to today, the Undersecretary of the Army signed a memo in January of last year saying that the REF is an institutionalized capability. Not the REF itself, but the rapid acquisition and the effects the REF has will be institutionalized within the Army, and they will be organic to TRADOC. Okay? So we've moved now in, I think it was 31, it was in January, I can't remember the date, but in January, we moved from headquarters DA staff for command control under TRADOC. We're a direct report right now to Lieutenant General Magnum for daily operations. We report to Mr. Brinkley and a G35. And we work in concert with the TRADOC staff. A lot of good about that, okay? If one of our primary outputs from our unique requirements authority side is to influence requirements, then there's a natural synergy to place us within TRADOC. We have a lot of good ties with the centers of excellence. We work regularly with the TICMs. So influencing those requirements and indoctrinating us into the TRADOC staff makes all the sense in the world to ensure that the intent of the capability is captured. Fast forward to how are we going to be responsive globally? Okay, so what we have to come up with is a way of predicting where to put our dollars against future requirements and future capability shortfalls. There's a lot of decrement lists out there, and a lot of work goes into in the COCOMs and in the Army Service Component Commands to identify where their capability shortfalls are. You'll hear it a bunch of times, constrained resources, we have to be able to focus our dollars at a requirement that might hit both PACOM, AVICOM, and Southern Command, if you will. As we mine across looking where the Army Service Component Commands are having common issues is where we're first going to focus against to try and help mitigate those issues. Okay, so that's how we're going to try and become predictive. which really gets through the first couple blocks, conduct solution analysis. We'll develop a requirement against those, against where we find common common shortfalls. We'll develop a capability, we'll insert it into that Army Service Component Command, and we'll provide leadership the feedback on that capability. That's in our base funding, that's based on our base funding, and that's how we're gonna try and become more predictive before a unit goes to a theater of operation, that we have something at least on the shelf. I'll give you an example, so I probably wasn't all that clear. I'll give you an example, hi Barry. I'll give you an example of how this is gonna work and how we just did it. Next slide. Okay, so 2ID, everyone's heard about sub-T environment, some of the capability shortfalls you have operating in subterranean environment, okay? So it's not just in the PACOM AOR and in 2ID where this is an issue. Anywhere where you have a hardened target or a subterranean target, you're gonna have the same type issues of situational awareness, ability to communicate, and actual moving of video from those target locations. What we did here was we talked with 2ID. We started working with a community of partners. We don't do anything alone. Some of the baggage that comes with the ref is people think we're out there running around on our own. Don't do anything wrong, we wouldn't get access, can't get it done alone. Typically, we're working with a host of others that help come up with what the problem sets are that we're trying to solve. In this case, we teamed well with, you can see the patches up here, but we teamed well with the Asymmetric Warfare Group, the Maneuver Center, and several others. Okay, we went through the solution analysis. It took us about 18 months. We ran a couple of exercises. We ran them CONUS first, and then we ran an exercise in Korea. We tested some capabilities. We developed a joint action plan. Right now, we're at informed leadership. We spoke with 8th ID. We spoke with 2ID. We have a company set of equipment tailored to the sub-T environment that we're going to insert into 2ID. We don't sustain it, we don't maintain it, it becomes a unit responsibility, but it definitely will empower at the company level a unit to be proficient within communications, movement of video, and situational awareness of a deep buried target or a hardened target. So that's inserted. What else did we do? We work with the Maneuver Center, they're documenting what that was, and in the future, they're preparing the requirement right now, and all of this information is allowed to help influence that requirement with what the state of technology is, what the state of something tested in a relevant environment is, and what the unit has the ability to go buy on their own right now, okay? And so that's how we would run this across that first chart and trying to be predictable. Next slide. Okay, so recent requirements. Everyone thinks that we've got less guys forward. There's no requirements coming in. Although I don't have it in this, I don't have it in this brief. We're exceeding the last 2 years' requirements at this pace right now. Cumulative requirements. We've done more this fiscal year than we've done in the last two fiscal years by a large margin. Why? Because there's less guys on the ground. There's less capability on the ground, and there's more demand for special type material solutions, elevated ISR at different levels, communications, longer range communications, and soldier kit. Obviously, soldier kit. Where we all went through lighten the load, you've got less guys on the ground. We're actually getting requirements that increase load, which is counterintuitive, but they're trying to take more stuff with them. Okay, and that's the unit commander's responsibility to work out, but we're seeing that regularly. Next slide. So parting thoughts. You can read the slide. The bottom line, the decision to institutionalize the REF, the decision to institutionalize the unique authorities of the REF really run, they dovetail into what we're doing here talking about the pace of innovation. It was the reason senior leadership put the REF in place to begin with. Partnering with other organizations like the Asymmetric Warfare Group, established at the same time, provides that balance between the two organizations in TRADOC that transition from the Army staff and will help really inform innovation, future requirements, and capabilities to the soldiers at a faster pace. That's what we're for, and that's really what I got to hear and came here to tell you about. Willing to take any kind of questions.